as a feminist, I do want a woman to be president, but it needs to be the right woman. We need this nation to get on her feet. I think this is it. Hi, is this Carly Fiorina?
It is, Tammy. How are you?
I am great. Thank you so much for doing this. I know you're busy. You've just done a speech, I believe, in New Hampshire, and I really appreciate you coming on the show.
Well, thank you for having me. I appreciate being with you.
You know, a lot of people, fortunately, because of your in Iowa, the Freedom Summit, the speeches you're giving, the interviews you're giving, people are getting to know you. They know your name, but they've never really had a sense of what you stand for. You've been, the New York Times is even coming out saying that, you know, people are swooning, and yet the polls really aren't showing that yet. And I want to discuss that in particular, because we know that there's a lot of people in the lineup for running for president. As on the GOP side, of course, you're the only woman. I am very impressed. You may not remember this. We both served on the Schwarzenegger transition team in California.
I do remember. Yeah. I do remember.
And what's funny is, of course, one of the things that you're faced with is a suggestion that a woman and hormones would affect your ability to lead. And we know from the Schwarzenegger experience, of course, that hormones do affect people. It's usually not women, is it?
That's right. You know, one of the things I always do in an audience is say, ladies, can you think of one occasion where a man's judgment was clouded by hormones? And, of course, all the women laugh, but all the men laugh even harder.
Yeah. Well, we know. And see, this is the clarity, and it's partly because you come from, I think, outside of the Beltway. But when we look at, we've got some debates coming up, and I think that's going to be key for people to see you in action in that regard. Fox has set up a new set of rules. You've got to be in the top 10 of 5 national polls. You aren't there quite yet. What can you tell people? What are you going to be doing in order to make the grade in August with the Fox debate?
Well, first of course, polls are lagging indicators, and we haven't seen any national polls since I announced my candidacy. So all the polls that you're referring to came out before I announced my candidacy. And so I think what we're going to continue to do is what I've been doing, working really hard to make sure that people know who I am, see who I am, that I communicate with as many people as possible, that I take all the questions, that I answer all the questions, and I think we'll see the polls move. We have 10.5 weeks to go. So I'm actually glad to know what the rules are so that we understand what goals we have to hit.
Yeah, there's never been a GOP debate with more than 10, apparently, in the primary season, so that's not an unusual number. In the speeches I've listened to, and I really do hope, and I'll be spreading around your Iowa Summit speech, when it comes to the issues we're facing, the economy and foreign policy, people are surprised when they hear of your extensive foreign policy experience. Can you give everybody a little bit of some background on why you know so much and why you've met all these leaders? What made that possible?
Well, I've lived and worked and done business and charity work around the world for a long time. So it's true that I know more world leaders on the stage today than anyone else running, with the possible exception of Hillary Clinton. But I never did photo ops. So, you know, I sat with Vladimir Putin. I've sat in Bibi Netanyahu's office. I've sat with the Chinese leadership. I've sat with Saudi, with Jordania, et cetera. And what I've been talking with them about is sometimes business, sometimes charitable work, sometimes their emphasis on education. But I have had extensive experience in the world and with world leaders. And beyond that, of course, I served as the chairman of the advisory board for the Central Intelligence Agency for several years. I've advised several secretaries of defense, a secretary of state, a secretary of homeland security. So I do have a lot of experience, and I know that the world is a more tragic and a more dangerous place when we're not leading, and of course we are not leading right now.
Right. There's a lot of arguments you'll hear from certain quarters about why women shouldn't be or couldn't be president. Do you make any argument that women make a difference specifically because of gender and our world point of view, or do you think that it's a wash when it comes to leadership?
Well, I think there are some common characteristics of leadership. Leaders, whether they're men or women, always challenge the status quo, for example. Leaders always see possibilities, frequently, that other people don't see, and they motivate people to seize those possibilities. I think, on the other hand, it's also true that women tend to collaborate first, and tend to seek common ground. And so women tend to be doers and problem solvers. It's not to say that men aren't. It's just that women, to achieve anything in our lives, we've learned how to solve problems and find common ground with others.
When it comes to your, I suppose, not mentors necessarily, but those who've inspired you, who and this is how we kind of get a good sense of people, who both men and women in the, not necessarily just politics, but if you had to name a couple of people that we all would know who've really inspired you and who are a reflection a bit about how you would approach the world, who would that be?
Well, first, I just have to start, no one knows them, but I have to start with my own mother and father because, honestly, the older I get, the more valuable I realize their lessons were, lessons about integrity. My mother saying, what you are is God's gift to you. What you make of yourself is your gift to God. I've learned in my life that everyone has God-given gifts. It's just not everyone has the opportunity to fulfill and find their gifts, and this country has to be a place where that's possible for everyone regardless of their circumstances. But if I had to think of a political figure, for example,
yeah,
I would choose Margaret Thatcher, a woman who really beat the odds, who was underestimated by so many, but also a woman who came in and really faced the necessity to change the order of things in her nation. And I think we are at that point in our own nation, honestly.
Yeah, because this is the difference between people who are going to be managers of the monster, which is what I see a Jeb Bush being, versus people who are going to change the structure out of necessity because we can't move anymore. We are so large. It's the VA. It's just, it's, that's got to be an infection in every single agency that when you get, it's like the guy who weighs 1,000 pounds who's grown into the easy chair and says, give me one more pizza and I can get up. When in fact, you've got to do a complete and total intervention with what we're facing on the international scene and with the economy. Do you think you would be able to do both things, or do you think that this is now we just get swamped with needing to manage it?
Well, your point about the difference between management and leadership is key. I talk about this all the time. Managers are people who do the best they can within the status quo. And we got a lot of managers in politics.
Yeah.
They may talk a good game, but when it's all said and done, they don't actually challenge the status quo. Leaders change the order of things for the better. Their job is to challenge the status quo. And we are at a point now where we need leadership. You're right, our government is so big, so bloated, so costly, so complicated, so corrupt. It literally is no longer serving the people who pay for it. And actually, only the wealthy and the powerful and the big and the well-connected can deal with this big, bloated government. But we have to do both at the same time. In other words, we must lead in the world and we must have leadership in Washington, D.C. as well. It can, all these things can be done at the same time, but it will take leadership. We have to push back against our enemies. That doesn't mean rushing off to war, but it does mean doing some very specific things, and we have to cut this government down to size so that it is more responsive to those who pay for it and to those who it should be serving.
Now, Mitt Romney was mocked a lot because of his, just, quote, just being a governor of not knowing much on the international scene. We look back now, and he was right on virtually every single issue, including Russia at that point being our biggest geopolitical foe. Who would you say, when you look at the international scene, fits into that framework now? Of course, now we have ISIS on the scene. Russia is still an issue. Iran is going to have to be dealt with the mess of what's being created now. What do you see as the first, is there a singular first priority for you when you get into the White House on the foreign policy scene?
Well, I think all three of those that you mentioned are important, and we can do something about all three. My first phone call would be to Bibi Netanyahu of Israel to reassure him that our nation stands with Israel, but also to reassure all our other allies, because our other allies, even when they don't agree with Israel, when they see how we treat Israel, they worry about their own alliance with us. My second phone call would be to the Supreme Leader of Iran. He might not take the phone call, but he would get the message. And the message is, until and unless you open every nuclear facility you have to full and unfettered inspections, we will exact the most punishing financial sanctions we can. And we don't need anyone in the P5 plus one's permission to do so. And China and Russia have never been on our side of the table anyway. With regard to Russia, they're things, very clear things we can do. We should rebuild the Sixth Fleet. We should rebuild the missile defense program. We should conduct regular exercises in the Baltic states, and we should arm the Ukrainians. And with regard to ISIS, we ought to be holding Camp David summits, not to talk them into some bad deal with Iran, but to work with them on defeating ISIS. Our Arab allies know this is their fight, but they've asked us for very specific kinds of support, and we haven't given it. So we ought to arm the Kurds. We ought to give the Jordanians bombs and materiel. We ought to share intelligence with the Egyptians. We ought to work with the Turks. I mean, all these things they've asked us to do, we haven't done them. So we need to bring that group of nations together, lead them and support them, but they will fight this fight if they believe we are with them.
What is the first thing you would do when it, I think when it comes to Obama's executive orders, but for the economy, is there something you can do on your own immediately that would jumpstart what's happening here, get us back on our feet in the White House? What, do you have an idea of if there's something specific you could do that that would change the environment right now when it comes to the sluggishness, the issue of jobs, the number of people who are off the rolls, the record number of people, 92 million, not in the workforce? What could you do right away to make a difference?
Well, first you have to roll back all of the executive orders that he's put out there, because every single one of them has an impact on the economy, including, by the way, the 400 pages of regulation over the Internet that got written by the big companies. But a lot of the things that we need to do will take the American people's pressure on Congress, because they will require Congress. So we have a 70,000-page tax code. We need to simplify it radically. We have government agencies in which we know, because it's been documented, there's hundreds and hundreds of billions of dollars of fraud, waste, abuse, and corruption. All that weight crushes the potential of this economy. We need to root all of that out. We need to make sure that we're no longer paying people in the government for, say, watching pornography, which we know goes on every day. I mean, every single one of these things I mentioned can be done, should be done. It's not rocket science to get it done. It's just it hasn't been done because no one's been willing to really challenge the system.
You know, it's fascinating because these things are easy to do. That's something that most Americans would agree with, and yet it doesn't occur because there's such an investment in the system as it exists.
That's right.
Maybe it's also just about a lack of an imagination, which is where I think somebody who is, if as an example, if you're president, that is a message that we do want something significant to occur. Now, we also know, and this is inspiring, but you're a cancer survivor. How is your health now? Is how does that, what's the outlook there, and how would you explain that to the American people, knowing that you've been through this and you've recovered?
Well, my health is wonderful. I am one of the lucky ones. I'm a survivor. And for all the cancer survivors out there, and there are so many, we know that life goes on, and we know that we have a life expectancy that's as long as people who haven't battled cancer. But it's also, I would say, I wouldn't wish cancer on anyone, but in a way, it was a blessing in my life because it gives you a different perspective. I was blessed by the kindness of so many strangers. My family grew stronger. My faith grew stronger. And I think it also reminded me that every single one of us has an opportunity to really make a difference. And the highest calling of leadership is to unlock potential in others. And we need leadership now that will unlock the potential of this nation. We can solve every problem. These things are not rocket science, as you point out. But we need leadership to galvanize the American citizenship to say, we need to make these changes now.
Right. And I would think that especially with your, look, we've got the greatest medical system in the world, the innovation that is happening, the invention, new things every day, the potential of that cancer is a manageable thing where it's not a death sentence. And yet so many now don't have access to the best in America, specifically because of the Affordable Care Act, you know, the absurdity
That's
of
right.
that. What would you do, depending on what the Supreme Court does, of course, in the summertime, what would you support Congress doing now? Repeal and replace, overturning it entirely? What would your approach with Obamacare be?
Well, we have to repeal it because the law itself is longer than a Harry Potter novel. So nobody read it. and it's accompanied by then another 40,000 pages of regulation. In other words, it's so complicated nobody understands it. And as a result, of course, you see hospitals consolidating, you see insurance companies consolidating. It's this big, complicated disaster. What we need to do is allow states to manage high-risk pools, because mm-hmm. no one should be unable to afford insurance because of a pre-existing condition, and sure. people who truly need help need to be helped. So let the states manage those high-risk pools, but let's try the one thing we've never tried. We have never tried the free market in the health insurance business. It's always been a regulated oligopoly, cozy little set of rules between insurance companies and regulators. Mm-hmm. We just nationalized that under Obamacare. Let's try the free market, where people actually get choices.
Wow. Wow. When you, and this is what I've, and look, as a feminist, I do want a woman to be president, but it needs to be the right woman. We need this nation to get on her feet. And we're in a position now where we've seen, all of the boys coming through all of the right schools, quote unquote right schools, with the same experience, the same rhetoric, and things keep getting worse and worse and worse. It doesn't matter which party they're from. It doesn't matter what they say they stand for. Everything, with the exception of President Reagan, everything has gotten worse. And your rhetoric, your sense of things is clear. And we know, look, I mean, we have ideas, and what happens when you get into the White House is going to be something else, and you're going to have all kinds of things you don't expect to come up on you. But what's very exciting, I think, and what people respond to when they hear you is this clarity, that they've been told that a person wouldn't understand foreign policy or wouldn't understand the economy unless you've been in government. I'm beginning to think, Carly, that maybe you need to have not been in government. Maybe you need to be from outside and only from in business. Would you agree that that's part of our issue now, is that we've got to have people coming in from the outside in order to fix this mess?
Well, I agree that we have a professional political class. But it's a modern invention, and it's not a particularly good one. Ours was intended to be a citizen government. It's what buy for and of the people means. So for most of our nation's history, people came out of private life and went to public service for a time and then returned to private life.
Right.
They didn't stay in politics their whole life. Politics is a certain kind of experience, but it's actually kind of a narrow experience. And it's a, you know, in politics, words count. In the rest of the world, actions speak louder than words. And I think what we really need in the White House is someone who actually understands how the economy works, who actually understands how the world works and who's in the world, who understands how bureaucracies work, because that's what our government is, one giant bureaucracy, who understands technology, which is a tool that can be used to change bureaucracies and to reengage people in the process of government, and finally, a leader who understands executive decision-making, which is a tough call and a tough time with high stakes, for which you're prepared to be held accountable. That's, I think, the experience that it takes to do the job.
Yeah, and one thing, I've got this, you've probably heard about this, the New Yorker magazine is out, and they've got, it's a cartoon, they've got a drawing of all the boys who are running in a locker room with Hillary on an outside of a door looking in, but neither you nor Dr. Carson are in the mix. Is this something you expect, and is this matter to you, or are you just going to move on and do all of your, advertising and your own work to get your name out there? What do you think when the legacy media literally disappears you from the environment?
Well, I think it just reconfirms what we know. The New Yorker magazine is a liberal publication, and people like me and Ben Carson aren't supposed to exist.
Right.
You're not supposed to have a conservative woman. You're not supposed to have an African-American conservative. And so they just paint us out of the picture. But guess what? The American people won't paint us out of the picture.
Yeah, you know, I agree. This is, it's very exciting. I'm thrilled that you've jumped into this, that you're in the arena. As a role model, the impact already on young women and young men watching in the nature of what's possible through the conservative ideal. Because we are, interestingly enough, we are the big tent. I mean, because this is about being able to live lives that best suit us. And the only way we're going to be able to do that is to have more control of our money, have a government that stays out of our lives, remember about the value of family, the importance of faith, and that's the only way we can live the American dream. And I think right now you're the closest one who represents that for everybody. I just can't thank you enough for being here.
thank you so much, Tammy, for having me. And, you know, I think as conservatives, we know that no one of us is any better than any other one of us. And so all of us have to be equal, not just in the eyes of God, but equal in the eyes of the government as well. And today that's not true. The powerful win out, and the powerless are getting crushed. So that's why we need to return to conservative principles.
Excellent. And people, your website is carlyforpresident.com. I'm going to guess that donations will always be a major issue. Volunteerism, people should go to your website. You're in New Hampshire now. Is there any other place you need people to go? What can people do as we end here?
Well, please go to carlyforpresident.com. We need to know who you are. We'd love your financial support. We'd also love your volunteering support. So please let us know who you are. And thanks so much, Tammy, for having me.
It is an honor and a pleasure, and good luck to you. And I'll talk to you soon. Thank you, Carly.
Thanks, Tammy. Bye-bye.
Wow. All right, you guys. So look, it's one thing to be inspired, and it's another thing to speak with somebody who's got answers.